Nowadays, it is hard to imagine our life without the fruits of civilization, such as the internet, digital technology, the achievement of modern medicine and pharmaceuticals, space exploration. However, few people understand that all of this is the result of the greatest event in the history of mankind, the creation of quantum mechanics. Quantum technologies have long entered our daily lives. We are used to LED lighting shining from every corner. Screens on TVs and smartphones make use of quantum dots. All digital devices and their components, CPU, memory, are based on transistors. Optical fiber communications need lasers. GPS satellites carry atomic clocks. MRI scanners and medical diagnosis use quantum phenomena. Even at construction sites, distance is now measured with a laser rangefinder. But transistors, LEDs, lasers, GPS, MRI would never have appeared without quantum mechanics. Unlike accidental discoveries of Viagra and LSD, the technological developments provided by quantum mechanics are the result of carefully calculated research. Look at how nuclear weapons and nuclear energy have changed our world. Unfortunately, the history of science, and in particular the history of quantum mechanics, receives very little attention in modern popular culture, despite the major impact it has had on modern society. Schools devote more time to wars, rulers, and regimes. Compare the consequences of the First World War with the invention of the transistor. No one can reliably answer the question of where civilization would be if the First World War had not occurred, but it is impossible to imagine our life without microelectronics. The same is true for all times, past and present. Science shaped the face of civilization. Entire epochs are associated with scientific discoveries. Remember the invention of an aqueduct in antiquity. Newton's discoveries led to a rapid development of mechanics, besides pure mathematics, astronomy, and many other fields. The development of thermodynamics led to the steam engines. The creation of electrodynamics opened an electricity era. The scientific community has had a much stronger influence on civilization than any individual ruler. Take, for example, the creation of the atomic bomb. The Soviet Union ceased to exist. Stalin and Roosevelt are gone, but the nuclear weapons created by Oppenheimer and Sakharov still influence the world order, and most likely will continue to do so. So, let's explore the origins of the most significant scientific revolution since Newton, more influential than all historical events and world wars combined, the creation of quantum mechanics. We can identify several milestones in the development of quantum theory. The year 1900 is considered the beginning. The development era of the so-called old quantum mechanics belongs to the period from 1900 to 1925. It is a combination of classical Newtonian mechanics with so-called quantum conditions, propositions that contradict classical physics but are required for the explanation of experimental data. In 1925, Werner Heisenberg published his seminal paper, moment commonly marked as the birth of modern quantum mechanics. The ideas of quantum mechanics are radically different from classical Newtonian mechanics. The subject requires a level of mathematics that has never been used in physics before. Its ideas are counterintuitive, require new concepts, and change our worldview. Therefore, it seems extremely surprising that it takes only 2 years from the appearance of the Heisenberg article in 1925 to the final formulation of all the postulates. The 1927 Solvay Conference marks the final point in the development of quantum mechanics in its final, modern form. For many people, it takes more than 2 years just to study quantum mechanics, but for some, the ideas associated with quantum mechanics are too inaccessible to comprehend, no matter how much they study. Quantum mechanics was created by first-class geniuses. Of course, development also continued after 1927. New convenient notations were invented. John von Neumann and others identified mathematical structures underlying quantum mechanics. Various technical approaches emerged for analyzing specific problems. The so-called standard model, the theory of elementary particles and their interactions, is one of the greatest achievements of all these efforts. But the fundamental postulates laid down in 1925 through 27 remained unchanged. Let's go back to the origins of quantum mechanics in 1900. The gold dollar is declared the standard unit of account in the United States. The first line of Paris Metro and the Central London Railway are opened. Telegraph communication between Germany and the United States has been established via a cable laid down through the Atlantic Ocean. Zeppelin makes its first flight. On December 14, Max Planck delivers to the German Physical Society in Berlin his famous lecture on the law of radiation. Planck says that radiation can only be emitted in portions, quanta. The energy of the quantum is proportional to the frequency of radiation. The coefficient of proportionality is now called the Planck constant. Planck came to this radical hypothesis trying to explain the experimentally observed spectrum of thermal radiation. Let's discuss the physics of this phenomenon. It is known that all bodies with non-zero temperature, according to classical electrodynamics, emit electromagnetic waves. Our sun emits radiation mainly in the frequency range visible to the human eye. However, it also emits in the ultraviolet and infrared ranges, but to a lesser extent. One can plot the dependence of the radiation intensity on the frequency. If we ignore all the properties of the radiating body except its temperature, the graph looks quite simple. This emission of photons is called black body radiation. At first glance, it seems absurd how a black body can radiate. After all, it is black. But, in fact, that's the whole point. A black body doesn't reflect the light because it's black. It can only radiate, and it radiates because it has a non-zero temperature. Therefore, this radiation is called thermal radiation. Of course, this is an idealization to some extent, but physics mostly deals with such simplifications and idealizations. Scientists tried to derive a formula for this curve based on the first principles, Maxwell's classical electrodynamics. But all the predictions of classical physics turned out to contradict the experimental data. The function went to infinity as the frequency increased. The situation even got its name, the ultraviolet catastrophe. Max Planck managed to get the correct formula, but at the cost of departure from classical electrodynamics. He found that in order to get the correct result, he needed a quantum of energy, later called a photon. Of course, the idea of light particles was not new. Newton himself was a proponent of the corpuscular theory of light. But interference and diffraction experiments clearly pointed in favor of the wave theory of light. Since the time of Huygens, the corpuscular theory of light has been considered dead. The wave properties of light can be seen in hundreds of experiments, which seemed impossible to explain from the light particles' point of view. Therefore, Max Planck and his theory of light particles were not taken seriously until 1905. The first Russian Revolution begins. Las Vegas was founded. Walter Griffiths invents the vacuum cleaner. A 26-year-old patent office employee, Albert Einstein, publishes groundbreaking papers on special relativity, Brownian motion, and the photoelectric effect. Experimentalists observed the photoelectric effect since the late 19th century. For example, there is a known fact that the spark increases if one shines ultraviolet light on the electrode. And this effect did not depend on the light intensity, its brightness, but only on its frequency. Such behavior cannot be explained if we treat light as an electromagnetic wave. In wave theory, the energy depends on the wave's amplitude. The bigger the amplitude, the greater the energy of the wave. In the framework of classical electrodynamics, the falling electromagnetic wave swings electrons and tears them off the metal surface. These pulled out electrons form a spark discharge. The bigger the amplitude of the incident electromagnetic wave, the more electrons are torn off the surface and the greater spark will be produced. But in practice, it turned out that the electric discharge did not depend on the intensity of the incident light at all. The spark changes only when one shifts the frequency of the light. When the electrode is illuminated with ultraviolet light, the discharge occurs, but when visible light is used, the spark disappears. And increasing the brightness does not change the situation. Einstein elegantly explained the results of these experiments using the Planck hypothesis. The argument is extremely simple. According to Planck, the radiation is emitted only in discrete portions, quanta, photons. The photon energy is proportional to the frequency. If the energy of the photon is enough to tear an electron off the surface, then this electron will contribute to the electric discharge. If not, it will remain in the electrode and will not affect it in any way. Only the energy of the photons affects the velocity of the emitted electrons, not their total number. This was a beautiful and extremely simple explanation for which Einstein was formally awarded the Nobel Prize in 1921, although his main contribution to science is the theory of relativity. The Nobel Committee is extremely conservative and formally refused to give a prize for relativity even in 1921, when the validity of both special and general relativity was already obvious to everyone. After Einstein's publication on the photoelectric effect, physicists began to take Planck's theory of light quanta seriously.